Good morning. Good to see some new faces. Good to see everyone back. Well, let's open up with a word of prayer. Let's go ahead and just jump on into this. Our Heavenly Father, we pause for just a moment. We just stand in awe of you. We thank you that even though you run a whole universe, that your heart beats for us. We thank you so much that you came to this planet, that you died a death, and you defeated the evil one so that you could bring us back into your family. We are so grateful, God, for what you've done for us. Thank you for each person here. We just pray that as we look into your word today, that we would just see our Savior, that we would fall more in love with him and be those that stand in awe of such an amazing God. We give you all the praise. Amen. Well, we are continuing our study of David's heart. David's had a heart after God. Of course, we're not there yet, but we first started in our Samuel, and we're leading up to David. And I think it will really help you understand what David was up against, the challenges that he was up against, because it's never easy to have a heart for God. And it takes a conscious decision to seek God, especially with all the distractions that life can throw at you. But David's not on the scene yet, but we're getting a handle on the situation, the circumstances, the dynamics of what was taking place, so that when David does arrive on the scene, I think we'll understand a lot better what he had going for him. So let's see if we can move forward here. Let me tell you a story, qualities of a good soldier, okay? There was a powerful king. He was loved by his people. He had a very, very strong army. But his oldest son wasn't the best son. In fact, he is going to create an insurrection against this king. And so the king has to at least put this insurrection down. He tells his general, whatever you do, put this insurrection down. However, do not kill my son. Okay? And this order was given to all of the soldiers. So not only the general heard this, but all of the soldiers that went out to war to fight this. So the battle enraged, and eventually the son was trapped, and he... Oh, don't die on me. Turn it on first. There we go. Okay. He got caught. Sorry about that. He got caught during the battle. He was trapped, surrounded by a number of the king's soldiers. One soldier, though, had the opportunity to kill him, but chose not to kill him. Okay. When that soldier came and reported to the general was furious. In fact, the general said, if you would have killed the son, because the son was leading an insurrection against the throne, I would have given you $1 million and I would have given you a rank. I would have given you a tremendous amount of honor. But the soldier made a very insightful statement. He said, even if he'd paid me $1 million, I would not kill the king's son. We all heard the king's command, win the war, but spare the son's life. What quality shines through in that soldier's life? Integrity, honesty. Honor, obedience, yeah, definitely, obedience, compassion, anything else to stand out? Strength, yeah, because when you have a conviction and you are challenged by that conviction, how well do you stand? I think the other thing, of course, and someone might have said it, would be loyalty. He was definitely loyal to the king, understood a chain of command, but ultimately the buck stops with what the king said. Well, this will make more sense as we proceed. Remember where we left off last week. The Jews did not have their Ark of the Covenant. They didn't have the Ark of God. It had been captured when Hophni and Phinehas, and were those good guys or bad guys?
Not so good.
Not so good. They were the sons of Eli, and oh my gosh, last week we went over in detail what they were doing, how they were taking advantage of their position, their power, and it was not a good scene. So, they bring the Ark of the Covenant into the battle, thinking that because they got the lucky rabbit foot, God's going to bless them. And of course, the rabbit foot got captured. The Ark of the Lord got taken into Philistine territory. We looked at what happened when the Philistines got a hold of it last week. That created some real problems When the Philistines got a hold of the ark, they realized there was just no way that they could stand against God. So they had to move the ark from town to town. Again, why did they have to move the ark from town to town? Yeah, they had some problems in the groin area, and plus they had a rat infestation as well. But they moved it from Ashdod to Gath, and finally they were going to move to Ekron. People of Ekron said, "There's no way you're bringing that thing here. That's the kiss of death for us. We're not going to take. We know what's happened to you all, so we're not even going to take it." Well, here's an interesting thing: for 7 months, the Jewish nation didn't have the Ark of the Covenant. So, how do you think they felt? Because remember how critical this is to their whole system of worshiping Jehovah. How do you think they felt?
They were lamenting.
Lamenting? Loss, yeah. Defeated, definitely defeated, because here you bring the Ark of the Covenant in and you lose. When was the last time that the Ark of the Covenant was brought into battle and they won? Do you remember that? When they were told to bring the Ark of the Covenant in? Long ago, yeah, it was long ago.
Jericho.
Yeah.
They're entering into the promised land.
That's right. Good job, Bob. Jericho. Yeah. Yep. About 300 years. So they're thinking that it happened once before. Let's do it again. Good job. They definitely feel distant. I mean, there's a separation when they don't have their main focal point with them, they're going to start feeling distant. And the other thing is, I wonder if they really started to doubt. I thought God was superior. I thought God was overall. And all of a sudden, it looks like he's losing. How that might have created doubts in some people. Many had let their hearts begin to drift away. And we are warned over and over again, Proverbs 4, guard your heart with all diligence, from it flows the springs of life. Deuteronomy 4:9, be on your guard, diligently watch yourself so that you do not forget the things your eyes have seen and so that you do not slip from your heart as long as you live. Teach them to your children and to your grandchildren. Well, we don't have the Ark of the Covenant as a New Testament church, but we do have things that help us in our worship, in our study, and our devotion to God. What if we didn't have any connection to First Baptist Church? Okay, and I'm talking about the building. I'm not talking about the people. The people are the church. Remember the word church, ecclesia, it means called out one. So if you're called out, if you are saved and the Holy Spirit's dwelling within you, you are the church, part of the church. But occasionally we refer to the building as the church. But just so that you know, the building is not technically the church, but we refer to it as the church at times. But what if we didn't have any connection at all to this building, to this facility, to this church? What if the doors completely got shut? So that means there's no main services at all. That means there's no Wednesday night meetings. That means there's no streaming internet at all. I mean, everything's shut down. And the worst possible thing is there's no Sunday school. That gets canceled. So how would you hold up? How would you fair in your walk with God?
It would be harder.
Yeah.
I mean, because you still have your quiet times in the mornings or the evenings or whenever you do it, but you wouldn't have that fellowship one another like we were told to do for Max.
That's right.
We just had to come over your house.
Yeah, that'd be interesting. Anybody else? Do you think you would? Could you maintain your walk with God as consistently? It'd be hard. It'd be hard. We are dependent upon each other. That's why we're referred to as the body. Your hand can't function independently. Your leg can't function independently. That's why we need each other. But it's easy to have your fervency or your closeness can be affected by that. Jesus mentions in Mark 4, but all too quickly, God's words crowded out by the worries of this life, the lure of wealth, and the desire of other things. In other words, when you don't have a weekly get together, as you come together, it's amazing how all of a sudden a lot of other things can start to just come into your life, start to distract you from focusing on God. So if the doors were closed, you know, this observation, over the last 12 months, since the fire, since the virus, etc., have you seen any changes in the devotion, desire, or diligence of the church body?
Yes.
In your own life? Yeah. I think this is very important, that even though we don't have an object that we focus our devotion to like the Jews did in regards to the Ark of the Covenant, we need to make sure that even if the church building is not available and our fellowship would be very limited or curtailed, that with kind of a church door closing event, that you still have your devotion, your fervency with Christ, very important. Because if closing the door can affect your fervency, then it means you need to grow more. Now, it doesn't mean you can grow completely matured without the interaction of one another, but we desperately need to be in our own walk, developing our walk well. And the New Testament church had a door closing event referred to in Acts chapter 8. All of a sudden, Saul agreed completely with the killing of Stephen in Acts chapter 7. A great wave of persecution began on that day, sweeping over the church in Jerusalem, and all the believers except the apostles were scattered throughout the region of Judea and Samaria. That closed the doors of the church in Jerusalem, and everybody had to flee. Think about how that could have affected the church in a negative way. The enemy was hoping that the persecution would not only scatter the church, but it would extinguish the embers of the church. He was hoping that by separating the people out, that their fervency, their devotion, their obedience, their loyalty to Christ would begin to wane. Of course, we know the rest of the story in regards to what happened. Can you think of some of the benefits from what happened in Acts chapter 8 with the church being forced to flee, so to speak, from Jerusalem? Some of the benefits that happened?
Going up to all four corners.
That's right. The gospel went out. Their routines were changed. Have you ever noticed sometimes it's easy to get into a rut, and spiritually you can get into a rut? And then that rut just becomes a nicer form of religion. It loses its passion. It loses its intimacy. It can happen in relationships. It can happen in a marriage. It just becomes a rut. This church closing door event in Acts chapter 8 definitely changed the routine. It helped them focus on the eternal. This is always a blessing. The Lord sometimes will bring a situation into your life because he wants you to just continue to focus on the eternal and not be distracted with the temporal. It'll definitely make you aware of the warfare. I think we have seen in First Baptist Church the intensity of the warfare. And remember, spiritual warfare always manifests itself in your physical domain. Look at Job 1 and 2. Satan had pretty much full authority to go after Job. And how did he go after Job? How did that spiritual warfare manifest itself? Attacked his family, attacked his business, attacked his finances, attacked his reputation, attacked his health, attacked his marriage. So much of what we experience more often than not is probably attacks coming from the evil one, especially if you're getting serious about your relationship with God, because God uses people who are committed and loyal to him. Their spiritual gifts were definitely infused with power, and of course, as it was mentioned, the gospel got proclaimed. So, the Jews at Beth Shemesh were excited to have the Ark show up, but it was really just a short rejoicing. The people of Beth Shemesh, when they looked up and they saw the Ark, they rejoiced at the sight. They sacrificed the cows, and the Levites took down the Ark and the chest and placed them on a large rock. So, after 7 long months, the Jews not having their focal of the temple, the high priest had been killed. Eli fell back and broke his neck because he was slightly overweight. Hophni and Phinehas were killed. And so you had this complete disruption in Shiloh where the focus of the worship was. So really, they were just drifting for those 7 months. And then finally, the people, they show an outward devotion when the Ark of the Covenant shows back up. It's kind of like sometimes it's real easy to be excited and look good on Sunday. And so during that time of worship, they went through the ritual. The Levites took down the Ark of the Lord, together with the chest containing the gold objects. They placed them on a large rock. On that day, the people of Beth Shemesh offered burnt offerings, made sacrifices to the Lord. It sounds like everything's going great. It sounds like a revival has broken out. It sounds like their hearts are really on fire for God. And it just sounds like, you know, what could go wrong? I mean, it's looking good. Everything looked good on Sunday. People looked spiritual. Songs were sung with joy. But then comes Monday. And here comes the heart check. So often than not, Monday is when the battle, of course, even Sunday afternoon, the battles just can start right up. It's easy to go with the Sunday morning excitement, rejoicing in worship, but how do you respond to the Lord when it's over? Well, if you read ahead, you know what happened there. What happened? Yep. They rented Indiana Jones in the Temple of Doom. The Lord struck down some men of Beth Shemesh because they had looked into the ark of the Lord. He struck down 70 men among the people. Why did they do this?
They didn't trust that God would protect his stuff, I guess.
His stuff. I like.
I don't know why. If the Phillips had done something to trick
them. They wanted to look at the hemorrhoids, that's it.
Anyone else? Remember, those were in a separate chest, so they could look at those and the rats and be okay. Right.
But the Lord had been real specific about this.
Right.
2,000 years before, you do not touch or look at the covenant of the ark. Anybody within the faith would not surely remember. But yet, we take it upon ourselves to look in the ark.
Right.
That's part one. Part two is 70 men were struck down. I think that tells the rest of the people on the heart check for Monday. I'm here.
Yep. That'll get your attention, especially in a small community. What were they looking for? What were the objects that they were most likely looking for? Okay, you got the two tablets, the Ten Commandments, Aaron's rod, that bud, and a jar of manna. That's right. That's what they were looking for. But in there, we'd better check to make sure the Philistines didn't take anything out of the ark. They're going to violate a major component of God's character in order to just make sure that, God, you might have missed some. God, you might not be aware that they might have taken something, or they might have put something in there that shouldn't be there. I mean, they might have put a little, you know, piece of beef jerky or, you know, some roast pork inside there. Something. Lord, you want to check this out. Another mouse stuck in there. This should never happen. Yeah, they were adding to it, and they were taking away from the attributes of God himself. I mean, this, remember, this isn't just some little podunk town. Beth Shemesh was a Levite town. So this, you know, people might say, well, what about the Philistines? Didn't they look in the Ark of the Covenant? It never says they did. They probably didn't have time. They were so worried with other issues. But it never says they looked into it. Well, how come God didn't strike them dead when they moved it around because they didn't have Levites moving it like they should have? Well, God in his mercy didn't strike them dead that way, but he showed his glory and he manifested his holiness and his power in a different way to them.
His covenant was not with him either.
Exactly. Yeah, they didn't know. They wouldn't know. But it's interesting, they almost showed more respect for the Ark of the Covenant. They almost had they definitely had a fearfulness after 7 months. Yeah. They did. They had a healthy reverence for it.
And they were told something up there when they sent it back. They weren't in a very good place spiritually, I imagine, do you think? Because
the Jews?
They had lost the Ark and then because they had disobeyed. Now they didn't do what they were supposed to do, so I doubt they were in a great place. They could have been, but I
No, I think from our previous discussion that they weren't in a great place. I think they felt defeated. They felt discouraged. They were doubting whether or not, you know, I thought God always won, but it looks like God lost. So I think for 7 months, their quiet time slipped. Their fellowship slipped. Their own faith and walk with God slipped. And so because something of this magnitude should never, ever have happened, especially in a community of priests, it should have never, never happened. They looked good outward, but inward, we can see by their actions that they were having a real problem. They were unfaithful to the Lord. Numbers 4 tells us But they shall not go in to see when the holy things are covered in the tabernacle or touch them, lest they die. I mean, what attribute, one of the attributes of God was he trying to communicate with this separation? His holiness. God, I mean, remember, the Ark of the Covenant is kept in the Holy of Holies, which is a secondary room in the tabernacle. The priest only can go in there how many times a year?
Once
a year. On the Day of Atonement, the high priest. This would be something that the Jews, you couldn't forget this. You just couldn't forget this commandment.
Okay. How many times do we do what they do? Well, here, I can help God out.
Yeah. Over those 7 months, without experiencing the presence of Christ or letting the weeds grow in their heart, they lost their reverence. They lost their awe of the Lord. I mean, they just lost focus of who our God is. The Lord struck down 70 men among the people, and the people mourned because of the heavy blow the Lord had dealt with them. And especially since this was a Levite, a priest community town, that judgment was swift and meaningful to the town. I should have known better.
And the Philistines were there to watch how the Israelites felt when they came back in, but they left before they saw what happens when you disobey.
Yeah. The men of Beth Shemesh asked, who is able to stand in the presence of the Lord, this holy God? Now, I find that very interesting, because that's the very thing that they completely forgot about a minute earlier, is that we serve a very holy God. We serve a God that is so pure he can't even look upon man apart from the atonement that is given. To whom should the ark go from here? In essence, they're doing the exact same thing the Philistines done, because they treated God with such disrespect or just lack of reverence. They needed to get rid of the ark because they realized we can't stand in God's presence. Of course, again, I'm boggled that they just didn't realize they're doing it wrong. You're just violating some of God's commands. When you, in your own personal life, start violating a few of God's commands, usually you start running into walls or roadblocks or opposition. God is wanting to get our attention, get us back to basic obedience and loyalty to him. They had forgotten the awesomeness of God. Then they sent messengers to the people of Kiriath-Jearim, saying, the Philistines have returned the ark of the Lord. Come down and take it up to your own town. I love how you only included half the story there. So the men of Kiriath-Jearim came and took up the ark of the Lord. They brought it to Abinadab's house on the hill and consecrated Eleazar, his son, to guard the ark of the Lord. The people had become too complacent in their walk with God. They lost their hunger for intimacy with God, and they allowed distractions to hinder the fellowship with God. And I just thought, wow, you know, what can come into my life that could create the very same set of circumstances? And I find it interesting that we're kind of coming out of a dark winter, you know, where the church has really been through a very difficult time, and we're not out of it yet. And I don't think we're going to get out of it. In fact, I would anticipate even more opposition from the enemy, because we, as Jeff mentioned in Generations, March 8th, there, if you were there that Sunday, that was an incredible time of worship. We had the Lord's Supper that day, and it was just, there was a very powerful moving of God's Spirit. And it doesn't surprise me that before God pours out his blessing, the enemy is always going to come in advance to try to stomp it out, just like what happened in Acts chapter 8. That church was on fire, and it was about ready to explode in a good way. And sure enough, the enemy, in his limited wisdom, thought that if he brought persecution, if he brought a big enough trial into that church, it would distract, it would discourage, and it would defeat that New Testament church. But he didn't realize the more you stomp on the sparks, the further they fly out, and more fires get started. And so be prepared for the enemy to come against your own personal life. If you're serious with God, if you want to have more intimacy with him, realize that he's going to come against us, but we need to be able to drop to our knees faster, because we cannot stand against this enemy in our own strength whatsoever. Taking time to see the awesomeness of God, Paul writes the Corinthians, I'm afraid that even as the serpent beguiled Eve by his cunning, your minds may be corrupted and led away from a sincere and pure devotion to Christ. We can get caught up with a lot of activities, and there's nothing wrong with activities, but we just can't lose that intimacy, that devotion that God wants us to experience in our life. Like a marriage, it can become very cold, and yet you can be in the same house doing all the things you always do, but there's just a coldness in it. There's not a fervency. There's not an excitement. There's not a devotion, and that can happen in our spiritual walk so easy. Take time just to be in awe of our amazing Lord. Oftentimes, when I feel like that coldness may be coming into my heart, I try to take some time and just go outside. Nature, creation is one of the best things God's given us, designed for us to be reminded of his awesomeness, his amazingness, his power, his immensity. When I see and consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have established, what is man that you are mindful of him, and the earth-born man that you care for him? You've made them a little lower than the angels, but you crowned them with glory and honor. And this is one of the things that's going to separate David out, is that he took time to be consumed with the awesomeness of God. This is showing us a comparison between the priest at Beth Shemesh and David, who's soon to come on the scene, how David took time to be consumed with how amazing his God was. He didn't let all the activities, all the duties crowd out his devotion to the Lord. He took time to experience God. Questions, comments? Well, like that good soldier who was faithful to his king, and does anybody know where that story comes from? Talca, it's in the Bible. That story's in the Bible. We'll get to it, because that was David and Absalom and that whole story there. And the general Joab, so the whole story. And the soldier did say, even if you pay me an incredible amount of money, I would not go against the king's word, because the king, I'm loyal to the king. So true story, we'll get to it in depth. But how loyal are we? And this is not to discourage, it's to encourage. It's how loyal are we? It is required that those who have been given a trust must prove faithful. God has given us, oh my gosh, an incredible opportunity. You're one of the few people on planet Earth that actually have a reborn relationship with the Creator. He wants to infuse you with his love so that you're captivated by what he's done for you. And then from that devotion, from that excitement, from that amazing experience that we have with him, then he uses us to be a blessing to other people. No soldier on active duty gets distracted in the affairs of civilian life. He avoids them so that he may please the one who enlisted him to serve. So is my heart still fervently in love with the king? Do I still long to please him, to know him, to love him, to serve him? The example the men at Beth Shemesh give us is really a heart check. I mean, it's easy to just to blow through that portion. But I just thought, you know, that should have never happened. And sometimes you can see believers, and it's like year after year after year, and you get a few years down the road, and they're just, they don't seem to be faithfully following the Lord like they did at one point. And you have to wonder, what's come into their life? What's distracted them? What's turned away that fervency that they once had for Christ? What caused them to slow down in their relationship with God? And I don't know. I mean, I know I have enough distractions in my own life at times. It's a constant battle to be maintaining a focus and to continue to seek God. But I'll tell you, coming together is one of the best things that can help us to be encouraging one another, strengthening one another, praying for one another, holding one another up. Boy, I can see why the enemy loves to create a separation or to keep people away, because it's in that one together, encouraging one another, that just so stimulates and encourages and invigorates our spiritual life. Amen.
I was thinking, take a shortcut to do something is a shortcut in your spiritual life. I think if I don't have my quiet time, when I get busy, I usually do it at work. If I start off that day and just get busy doing something, I don't do it. Then that shortcut, because I got busy, I didn't take the time, I didn't focus on Christ.
That's right.
My day's not going to be the same. My week's not going to be the same. So, got to put effort into it in a relationship.
That's a good point.
We'll just show up at the same school, listen to you teach to us. And then we go listen to Jeff, and then we're good for the week. It doesn't work that way.
Mm-mm. No.
And I've been that, believe me, I'm speaking about myself. I've been that way many times.
Absolutely. Someone sent me a text last week that said, hey, just want to let you know, I come to Sunday school class not to hear you. I thought, what? He said, I come to hear the Lord speaking his word through you. I thought, well, that's why we all come. It's to hear God speaking to us from one another. And that's why the Paul says, you know, speak to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Encourage one another with God's word. Speak to God what he's been feeding you with to other people. I mean, that's probably, I get more encouraged by people saying, look, I was reading this portion of scripture, I was looking at this part, you know, in Psalms, or I was reading this in the Old Testament, and it's like, this is, and it's like, that just so blesses and encourages individuals and how we need to be encouraging one another. But if you're not having the time of feeding, if you're not having that quiet time, if you have nothing inside your, you know, bread drawer to dish out to others, then it's kind of an emptiness. It can be real, real shallow sometimes.
It's interesting, Michael, as we've gone through this, my company, I'm sure a lot of other companies, you've had to really start dealing with mental health issues and the separation and speaking and through a computer 10, 12 hours a day or talking. And it's been interesting to watch, even in the secular world, of how the separation has caused a lot of anxiety, has caused a lot of challenges, caused a lot of depression. And I think about, you know, as Christians, we've all been separated, and thankfully, we've had the internet, or we've had, maybe we come to church or things like that. But this is a recharging point. It's a
good
part of coming together. And like you said, and I'm with you, I sometimes, you know, come to church and I'm lazy. Just feed me. I don't want to go get my own crops. I don't want to do my own work. But I think that's one thing that this last year with COVID, from just the secular side, has really showed the importance of being people being together and the socialization.
That's good.
And how people are just yearning. And I have some staff that are based in New York, and they've been in this 450-500 square foot apartment, can only take their dog out once a day. I mean, I don't know how they've survived, but they have. But there are people like that that just yearning to have that fellowship with people.
That's a good point.
I think part of that is that we can come, and y'all talked about, you know, we can just come and sit and soak in and go home, and we gain knowledge, but maybe not too much beyond that. I think that we have to come to a point of being vulnerable enough to allow people to see our own frailties, our own spiritual down, you know, failings, and but the strength to be able to do that comes from your own personal relationship with the Lord. And I don't mean like just telling everybody what your sins were for the week.
Right.
I mean like really being able to share, to say, this is how I come through things. How can I help you?
Exactly. That's really good.
That's really the main part of the church gathering, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's not just about gaining information.
No.
It's about knowledge. It's about sharing and supporting each other and being there. But you have to be vulnerable enough to.
It's the building of relationships, and that's, you know, sometimes in the past, Promises class has struggled with that in regard. Sometimes we can be a big class at times, but if you don't have the fellowship, if you don't have those individual relationships growing along with that, you can come and like, oh, that was very interesting information, but my heart didn't really get connected to it, because that connection comes through individuals. You know, over the years, I don't know how long I've been teaching Promises class, but sometimes people have come to me afterwards, you know, after they've been here for a while, and it's like, you know, I don't know if this is the class for me. And I said, well, why? And they said, well, it's just the people aren't real friendly here. And I said, you come into this class? and I said, well, let me ask you. Well, they say, you know, well, no one's ever asked me out for lunch. No one's ever asked me out for dinner. No one's ever. And I said, well, who have you asked out? And I meant it with all sincerity. I said, well, sometimes to be a friend, you have to show yourself friendly, as it says in Proverbs, and you have to just take that step. And I know it can be tough, especially when you're shy, or, you know, you just like breaking into a group of people. But I think one of our biggest things that we continue to strive on is try to break through those barriers so that we develop those relationships. And of course, we haven't had many activities for the last year, obviously, but that's one of the things that we try to do is have activities, have things where not everybody can come at once because that's never going to happen, but have enough activities so that people can build those relationships. And I've been encouraged just to see how many people are asking other people out for lunch or go out for lunch and things like that. But sometimes you just have to be the one that just says, you know what, I'm going to take you out for lunch. And I'll tell you, you eat a meal with somebody, and it's amazing how much that relationship gets developed, gets built, and gets strengthened. So,
because here in this class, we go out to lunch with several people. So if y'all ever want to go out to lunch with us, that's where we're going for lunch.
What was that?
Yeah, I always count on you, Dan.
From the past year, the mental health of people has really declined. There is suicide has gone sky high, and it's all because God created us to be together.
Absolutely.
He created us to have relationships with one another, not
right.
just husband and wife or,
right.
or girlfriend, that type of thing. He created us to be together. So these people and schools, oh God,
yeah.
schools, these young students are killing themselves because they can't be with their friends. It's because God created us to have that desire to
right.
have relationships with other people. And these idiots in this country are not seeing that. I'm not going to name any names, but Cuomo is he is ruining New York City.
You know, for the first time, we were in San Antonio this week, and there were a lot of billboards talking about mental health.
Mm-hmm.
Are you depressed? Or those kind of things. There were people on street corners proclaiming the gospel with a microphone. And it was encouraging that, at least in that part, there are people that recognize the struggles that everybody's going through. It's not the lack of the job. It's not the $1,400 check. What am I going to do with it? It's not all that kind of stuff. It's the real deep issue of not
yeah.
being with people and not having that connection that is something more than just work, grocery store.
Right. Well, the enemy knows that. The enemy knows that. And that's one reason why Satan likes to keep people from Sunday school class, likes to keep people from coming to church. Again, is there a magic to it? No, it's just you need it. You really will not thrive without that interaction. Tony.
Yeah, well, it's like Zoom is like a two-edged sword, you know.
Yes.
Zoom can be used for good, you know, but then Zoom can also be used for bad, and it's becoming bad when we can't interact with each other.
You bet. Tony, what'd you have?
Sorry, Tony. Okay. I was just going to let everyone know, in case you weren't aware, Pastor Jeff's book, That Life Interrupted Book, is so good. He wrote it years ago. It had nothing to do with COVID, but it ties so much to everything that's going on now. But if you go to the FHH.org, FromHisHeart.org, you can actually download a link of that, a copy, so you can get a free PDF of that. So those of you
cool.
who have businesses and you know want to just kind of put that out there to them, you know, hey, you might enjoy this book, you can certainly
cool. Thank you. Thank you.
I love the word vulnerability because
yep.
I don't, it was years ago and I don't know who said this to me, but they said, you know, how many times were we walking in the hall? How are you today? I'm fine.
Yeah.
You know, and when you're really not fine, and I think you and I have had this discussion, when you're really not fine and you say, I am, you know, I'm fine, you're not really being honest.
Mm-hmm.
With people. So, you know, I got to the point after I heard that I didn't say fine. I said, I'm having a really rough day, or I'm not feeling well today, or whatever. And the response on the other side was like, oh, what do I do with that? So I started saying fine again, you know?
Well, I'm fine. You take care. I'll pray for you. I'll pray for you.
So I think the vulnerability.
It does.
It's a hard thing. It's easy just to kind of sit in a chair and sing a song.
Yeah.
That's the easy part of the Christian life. The hard part is really taking a chance on getting rejected.
And you have to take that one step further.
Yeah.
No, you need to take that one step further, because as much as we need that with each other, you've got to have that with the Lord. You've got to be able to go to the Lord and pour out your dirty laundry, your struggles, your battles, your issues, your complaints. Pour out your hearts.
It has to start there.
Absolutely. That's right.
Matthew West
Yeah,
that's exactly what's happening. That's his song. You made it exactly.
Well, let's not be like the people in Beth Shemesh, because they let the 7-month closed door close their hearts. So, Father, we thank you so much for each person here. We thank you for your love. Just cause us to be people that love each other more, because we're falling more in love with you. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen.